What's up, y'all? Y'all in the frat house. We back, man. We here at Real Steel, man. Y'all already know what it is. 2565 Western Chapel Drive, man. Appreciate you, Mike, for having us once again, man. Y'all already know what it is, man. Each and every other Wednesday, man, we doing this thing, man. We got some dope guests for you in the building tonight, man. Y'all already know how we do it, man. When you talk about Atlanta, when you talk about legends in Atlanta, when you speak of the greats that come from Atlanta, one thing I always notice is everybody that speak on it always bring this brother's name up. And for damn good reason, man. We got an Atlanta legend, man. We got a true player up in the building, man. We got Playa Poncho in the building, y'all.
What's up? What's going on?
What's going on, my brother?
May the blessings, my brother.
Thank you for pulling up in the frat house with me, man.
Hey, man, you know I had to come to the frat house, come kick with y'all, man.
What's going on, man? Good to see you, bro.
Hey, it's good to be seen, man. You know what I'm saying?
You know, we've been running into each other, too, a lot out there in them streets. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, man.
We've been going to events or whatever. Ain't no telling where we at. Like, we pop up to all kind of stuff. I be seeing Playa Poncho in the building a lot of times.
Hey, man, I got to be there, man.
You all over the A nowadays, man.
Hey, man, I've been all over the A all my life.
I thought you had slowed down, but I see you haven't. You still out here, man.
You just heating up right now.
Shit. Yeah, man, you know what I'm saying? Can't slow down, man. You know what I'm saying? If you don't see me, I'm in and out of town. That's all it is. I'm gonna be moving around, man.
Yeah, man. And we in that Decatur. This Decatur zone right here, man.
Yeah.
Decatur where it's greater.
Yeah, zone 6 all day,
and
man.
And that's where you from, my brother.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying?
So you home right now.
Yeah, I'm always home. You know what I'm saying? All through Atlanta, you know what I'm saying? And other places, too. I mean, I got second homes here and there, you know what I'm saying? But Atlanta is where I'm born and raised from, you know what I'm saying? With my birth certificate, see.
For sure, man. Shout out to Zone 6, man.
Yeah, man. Shout out to all the zones 1 through 6. You know what I'm saying? I'm all over the A. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, Decatur where I rep. You know what I'm saying? But I was born actually at Georgia Baptist over in the 4th Ward. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, word?
Yeah.
Okay.
So my first address before I moved to Decatur like this was 187 Wyford Avenue, Atlanta, Georgia. You know what I'm saying? Northeast Atlanta. Right. Yeah, yeah. So I'm in Atlanta and Decatur. I'm all of it. You know?
He said 187. Yeah.
And we got a saying in the frat house of something we coined called DNA, man, because, you know, the whole original frat house podcast is from Detroit. So we call it Detroit in Atlanta. Like, we always show love to Atlanta, and we get a lot of love from Atlanta. So, you know, if you ever hear us saying that DNA,
yeah,
it's because we love Atlanta, you know Detroit, what I'm saying, and we get a lot of
man,
love.
I'm going to tell you, man, Detroit has always showed me love, man. You know what I'm saying? When I first started out and I went to Detroit to do some shows and everything, man, Detroit has always shown love to Playa Poncho, and I greatly appreciate it, man. I got some real Detroit players out in Detroit, you know what I'm saying, that always been back and forth from Atlanta, you know, from Detroit to Atlanta, Atlanta to Detroit, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, when BMF came down to Atlanta, man, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, the whole Detroit family just came on down to Atlanta, and it was just even bigger, man. It's just love, you know?
Yeah, some of them old school hits you got, especially that What's Up, What's Up, we was banging that hard in Detroit.
Yeah, man.
That was way before I got here.
Yeah, man, that's what I'm saying. Man. Hey. I would go to Detroit. I go to the mall, man, and y'all, you know, Detroit malls is like, you know, it ain't no malls like Detroit malls, man, because you walk in there, you really get that player gear, man, for real, from the head to the toe, you know what I'm saying? For real, seriously. You know, the furs and everything, you're going to get everything at the Detroit mall.
Oh, for sure.
When I first went up in the Detroit mall, I was like, oh, my God, I got to come back and do some real shopping up through here, you know what I'm saying, get some of this place.
Where was you at? Eastland, Fairlane, Northland?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, you was on that east side. That's
And that's the other thing about Detroit, too. Yeah, but see, that we were talking about that once before. It's like, you know what I'm saying, most of Detroit players that do come down to Atlanta, they gravitate to the east side. You know what I'm saying?
And it's like it's in our blood.
You see what I'm saying? Now, I went to Detroit, and I just happened to go to the east side.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Because the east side is the real side. That's what it is.
All day, every day.
Oh, yeah. We got love for the west side, too.
Yeah, you know what I'm
saying?
Yeah, we do.
I got peeps on the west side of the D and the west side of the A.
Yeah. And that's the other great thing about it, too, though. I said, we all over here, you know what I'm saying? We show love. That's what it is, man.
Yeah, but that record, What's Up, What's Up, that was like, that's, and they still go crazy on that record in Detroit. Right now, today.
Yeah.
You know, that's like a dance song. Yeah, that
you really made a hood classic.
Yeah, that right there, it go crazy.
We could definitely vouch for In Detroit. How that record go crazy, even to this day.
Man, yeah, I thank y'all and everybody in Detroit, all my fans in Detroit, man, you know what I'm saying? I'm greatly grateful for y'all, you know what I'm saying? For everybody that has ever, you know, requested my record, bought my record, you know what I'm saying? And most definitely turned up to it, you know what I'm saying? Make them videos, at me in them and sending them on in. You know, I repost.
Hell yeah, y'all already said, make the videos to that What's Up, What's Up.
You know what I'm saying?
That Hit Squad, let's go.
And I ain't gonna dwell on the past too long. I'm gonna just touch on it and then bring it up to date. But how you feel about, and I asked the East Side Boys the same thing. Mm-hmm. How was it, like, when you did that video in 95? Like, that whole vibe, like, What was it like as far as, what's one of some of your best memories back then? And how wild really was it back then on the Freaknik tip?
Oh, Freaknik was definitely wild, man. You know what I'm saying? Freaknik was like, well, let me think. Okay, so, you know, you know Freaknik is like the black Woodstock. I would compare it to, you know what I'm saying? Everybody that don't know about Woodstock, you know what I'm saying? For the young generation, Google it, you know what I'm saying, look it up. But Freaknik is like, you know what I'm saying, the ultimate party that everybody had to come to. And actually, you know, we got the Freaknik documentary coming out on Hulu for the 2024.
Oh, for real?
Yeah, yeah.
So, oh, I got know the that thing was 2024. I've been hearing about it coming.
Yeah,
so. Oh, it's coming soon then.
Yeah, I got the Freaknik anthem on that. I might, you know, go ahead and let y'all sneak a peek of the Freaknik anthem that's on the Freaknik. The wildest story party never told, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Myself, Jermaine Dupree, you know, shout out to JD. He is executive producer of it. Uncle Luke, you know what I'm saying? My Uncle Luke on that thing, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. DJ Kids at Rock, myself, you know what I'm saying? And there's some other interviews from people. But we got, you know, of course, What's Up's on the documentary. At the same time, like I said, I got the Freaknik anthem. When I say Freak, you say Nick. On the Freaknik documentary coming out 2024.
Oh, that's gonna be lit. It's gonna be a lot of people looking at their mama like, mama, you was a whole hoe out there, wasn't
it? Yeah, she was. Yeah, she was.
That's mama, dope too. Like.
Hey, mama was busting open before it was busting in open time.
Hey, man, I'm telling you, man, it's like this, you know. People a lot of times don't think when they're at certain parties that the party will be so big that it'll be talked about years and years and years and years and years and years and years later.
I was just about to ask you that.
Yeah.
How much of a blessing is it, and how do you feel about that, to be a part of something and a part of a lot of things, like basically hip-hop history, mm-hmm. and it's still being talked about right now, and you still relevant to this day? How do that feel?
Man, it feels great, man. It's a blessing, you know what I'm saying? I mean, I didn't know it was going to be like this. I remember I wrote What's Up, and at my grandma's house, you know what I'm saying, in the two-bedroom house, you know what I'm saying? So, and I didn't know that the world was going to be singing it. When I first did my first show, Big Show, when I was on tour, and it was like 20,000 people singing What's Up back to me. And it blew me away because it was something I wrote at my grandma's house in the bedroom. But now you got 20,000 people. As soon as the beat dropped, it was like, it was just game over. It was just like, I mean, it was a summer fest. And it was black people, white people. Yeah, it was a show that hit me, you know what I'm saying, for real. Like, damn, this is it right here. You know what I'm saying? This one song done took me up through there. But, I mean, I hit the stage, the beat dropped. And so I said, what it is, what it ain't, what it gonna be, the whole crowd. Like 20,000 people shouted it back to me word for word. And I had my DJ like cut the music. And so he was like sliding it in and out at the same time. And these people were singing and their voices were so powerful. The energy that was coming from them coming back at me on stage was just like.
I know you was thinking.
How did it make you feel? Like.
He was like, oh, shit, I'm lit for real.
It felt like that. I'm lit for real, you know what I'm saying? But the whole thing, we didn't have social media back then, so, you know, nobody else could witness that, you know what I'm saying? Like how they get to see it from Lil Baby and all the other artists that's out here right now doing, you know, big shows and everything. But artists like myself paved the way for that, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
For the artists to be getting it, how, like, the Migos get it now, you know what I'm saying? It was like, yeah, in other words, you know, you got pioneers in Atlanta, you know what I'm saying, that was doing it before me. My OGs, MC Shady, you know what I'm saying? Success and Effect.
Shout out,
you know,
to Shady.
Shout out to Shady. You know, Raheem the Dream, you know, you got Mojo, you know what I'm saying? Kilo Ali, you know what I'm saying? Me and Kilo were the only two artists really that was coming out of high school with records then. You know, and I was younger than Kilo, so Kilo had just got out of high school. I was still in high school. But, you know, the whole thing is like, you know, you never know what can be. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I tell everybody, whatever your dream is, just go after it. But I didn't know when I wrote What's Up, it was going to be like that. You know what I'm saying? I knew it was jamming, but I didn't know it was going to be like that. Well, the world would take to it the way that they've taken to it.
Yeah. And those are classics. What's Up, Raheem the Dream, because we was playing all that in Detroit. And I didn't know really till 2005 that all that came out of Atlanta.
Yeah.
I thought it was like Florida bass, like Uncle Luke, because the bass was heavy and repetitive. And I thought, oh, right. Okay, that's some 305 shit. That's what's up. Not knowing that that was Atlanta shit.
Yeah.
And that shit was lit. And this shit's still relevant. They still play Kilo Ali, Raheem the Dream, you still right now today in Detroit. You go to any club in Detroit, and they're going to drop one of y'all songs.
Yeah, that's something I noticed too. Like, Florida was doing their thing, but I noticed like Atlanta had developed their own bass sound, you know, here and y'all own style of shit. Pretty much like Shadi, it's funny you mention him. Shadi was one of the first artists I remember, like with that kind of sound that we noticed in the D.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And we was definitely banging his stuff back in the day.
Yeah.
And that sound right there, it kind of carried over and kept going in Atlanta like early.
Yeah, that's all DJ Man on production and DJ Toomp, you know what I'm saying? The same Toomp that was producing for that produced T.I. produced, you know what I'm saying, Shadi back in the day, him and Mike Fresh. So you had DJ Toomp, DJ Mike
that
Fresh.
And
DJ Man.
I remember Mike Fresh.
And even my man Devastated that made I Wanna Rock for Luke, you know what I'm saying? And Shake What Your Mama Gave You. Devastated from Decatur.
Wow.
Yeah.
I thought he was from Florida too.
Yeah, man. Everybody thought he was from Florida.
A Decatur dude, maybe. I Wanna Rock.
Yeah.
Wow.
So is it safe to say Decatur really put Atlanta on the map?
Decatur where it's greater. All
right, yeah. Yeah, hey. Because I know when I first came and I got here, man, I started bouncing at Club Chocolate, which is now what, Cosmopolitan or Blaze now?
Club Chocolate? No, you talking about off of Glenwood?
Yeah.
Yeah, Cosmopolitan, the Cosmo, where they shortened it to it, yeah. Cosmopolitan.
That was the first club I started bouncing at when I got to here in Atlanta.
Right.
I started bouncing over there, and that's where I met Hershey, Sandman.
Yeah.
You know, them guys over there, you know, and I thought all them was really from Miami, moving down here, because they was playing they music, but not knowing it was all East Side shit.
Yeah.
You know, shout out to y'all, man.
Thank you, man. Shout out to everybody over there, too, at the old Club Chocolate, man. My dog Black and Ford and everybody, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, man. I mean, it's ATL history. A lot of people, you know, come to Atlanta and they don't get the real ATL history of Atlanta, you know what I'm saying? You got a lot of people, you know, number one, I salute y'all, you know what I'm saying? For doing this show, because a lot of people come to the city and tell it the way that they want to tell it instead of interviewing, you know what I'm saying, artists such as myself,
exactly,
you know what I'm saying, who are originally from Atlanta, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
we've been here all our life.
Yeah, but we try to tap into the real players, man. You
not try, saying? Y'all doing it, y'all caught up with the real player.
Yeah, that's really doing this, man.
Yeah.
And that's a good segue to something else I was about to ask you.
Okay.
The So-So Def Connection, I know you one of the originals that was down with that. How did you originally link up with Jermaine Dupri and kind of get started with that thing going on?
So I started off, my first record deal I tell everybody was from King Up with Jay and the J Team, you know what I'm saying? The first DJ crew out of Atlanta, you know what I'm saying? So myself and DJ Kizzy Rock and DJ Bonet, long live DJ Bonet, we formed a group called A-Town Players. So I was already signed with A-Time Players. So when we first came out, we had Whoop There It Is first, but we didn't know anything about copyright. So we had a song say, do the A-Town draw? Yeah, come on now, Whoop There It Is. So we had a dance that actually went with our song. So before I even got the deal at So-So Def, So-So Def was actually my third major record deal. I had already had two major deals.
Before that. And how did you link up with the So-So Def connection?
So Jermaine's dad actually signed me. A lot of people don't know that Jermaine's father signed me, Michael Malden. Shout out to Michael Malden. Lil Jon was the A&R with So-So Def, and they didn't have anything at the time. That he had said something about them doing a compilation or something, and he wanted me to, you know, come over or whatnot and be on So-So Def with it. Again, I was still, you know, like over at with A-Town Players. Kizzy had just left and he went solo, and he had just did his deal with Tommy Boy Records when he did the Yeah Shout the Yeah. So I stayed, and DJ Bonet stayed, and I added one of my other childhood friends, Lil Red, Long Live Lil Red, into A-Time Players. So we got the deal then with Warner Brothers Premeditated. So when you hear the two What's Up, What's Ups, that's because I did both of them. I did the one that was solo with So-So Def. I did that as a solo artist, Playa Poncho solo. But when Warner Brothers found out that I had a solo deal with So-So Def, they wanted the What's Up, What's Up too. So a lot of things, you know, y'all can read about that in my new book, you know what I'm saying, and watch it on my documentary. I get deeper into the deals and everything. But I was the first artist in Atlanta to have two record deals at one time.
Oh, that's what's up.
Oh, wow.
What's up, what's up?
That was going on simultaneously.
Yeah, and then I was, when I did the deal, so, I mean, I'm Uno. I'm the first So-So Def based all-star. But I already had a movement because King Up with Jay, the J Team, and A-Town Players. So it was like when I did What's Up, What's Up over there. What's Up was already recorded. Shout out to Tony Mercedes. Tony Mercedes actually was the executive producer on the What's Up, What's Up. And he gave me the finances that I needed to go into the studio and record What's Up, What's Up before we even took it to So-So Def.
So, let me cut you off, Dave. So the one with L.A. Snow, is that the first one or the second one?
It's actually the first one.
Okay.
But I had two deals, like I said, at one time. So I did that one first, then I came back and did the other one with A-Town Players. So once things didn't go right, you know what I'm saying, on that deal of me having two deals at one time, they took my verse off and put DJ Lynn on there, which is how you get A-Town Players, the new version of A-Town Players.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's what's up. Yeah. I gotta ask you this. All right, I know about your background, you know what I'm saying, with your uncle, you know what I'm saying, with the live instrumentation and everything. They definitely played with some of the greats, so I know you came up under that.
Yeah.
But I need to ask you, what I don't know is, do you play a live instrument?
No, I just play by ear, man, you know what I'm saying? I play my keyboard or whatnot, you know what I'm saying? But I never took, like, a musical class for that. I mean, you know, when
I'm surprised you never got into that, coming up under that.
Well, it was just really me being able to recognize a lot of other people's talent and have them play what I hear. You know what I'm saying? Because if you got somebody else, it's like, if you got somebody that can play what you hear in your head and you can get it out of your head into their head, and they can put their funk with it. Like my Uncle Bobby used to play 12 different instruments. And one thing he taught me, like with the bass guitar is one of my favorite instruments. I have played around with it, but I haven't, like, you
That's
know.
That's my favorite.
Yeah, I haven't stepped out to the world like, oh, just play a poncho on bass. Right. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I play around for my just satisfaction.
Yeah, my own. For sure.
But other than that, you know what I'm saying? Aunt used to tell me, you know what I'm saying, like with the bass line, you know, on a bass guitar, you want to make the bass guitar sound like a rubber band. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, I would listen to him demonstrate that, you know what I'm saying, at the same time and make it with his mouth and make it sound like that on the bass guitar. So it's like you want to have that bass sound like a rubber band, and you want to slap that thing. You know what I'm saying? You want to have that bump on that bass when you slap it. You want to slap it and have it sound like a rubber band. And then when you hit that slide, you want that slide to sound like a damn bear. You know, he used to say you want the slide to sound like a bear coming down on you. You know what I'm saying? When you bring that bass down, you want to make it sound like a bear. So it was different things that my Uncle Bobby taught me on. Just that, for instance, that was on the bass guitar. Then my uncle Benny, which is my youngest uncle, my mother's youngest brother, he taught me with the saxophone and the congas and percussions, you know what I'm saying, and drums, you know what I'm saying, syncopation, you know what I'm saying. Him and my uncle Bobby both taught me syncopation, but just, you know, being able to just do it and hear it as a child. And I watched them; they had all their own instruments and PA systems and B3 organs and everything. You know what I'm saying? They had everything of their own, so it made me want to have everything of my own, you know what I'm saying?
I definitely can relate when you say you hear something yourself as an artist and you relay it to the person that's playing and like try to give them an idea of what you're hearing in your head.
Right.
I've done that with a few producers, so I know what that is. Yeah. Matter of fact, me and Beats used to do that.
Yeah.
Beats right there behind the camera right there. You know, I tell her because she play.
Yeah, them drums.
She
yeah,
can play.
Yeah,
play.
She, yeah.
So, I tell her what's in my head and like kind of hum a few notes out to her or even get on there because I play a little bit by ear.
Dude.
And then once I give her that thing, you know, we got a thing where one of us birthed the baby, the other one raised it.
Dig. I got you. She done play at my uncle's too though, so she knows, you know, we grew up in the church. You know what I'm saying? So that we used to rock at church. Now our church used to we used to tear it down.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? We used to bring it down on Sundays, you know what I'm saying? And so you gotta imagine the funk that was coming in with the Lord's spirit at the same time, you know what I'm saying? It was the funky spirit that was doggone that was there to give praise, but it was still to the point where you could enjoy it, you know what I'm saying, and feel great about the music. The music would turn you up so much it had you sweating like you would have thought you was at a club, but you at church.
Yeah. And that's one thing I always noticed about you. That's a good segue into you a real spiritual brother. That's one thing I always noticed about you. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You definitely laid back. You be on your cool shit at all times. Definitely play it, but you're a real spiritual brother. You always got a great spirit and positive, and like some of the philanthropy you do and the giving back,
the energy,
you know, and just interacting with you, period. You know, I noticed that you never let go of that godliness and that good spirit within you.
He ain't never let go of me, so I can't let go of him. You did. So it's like, you know, you got to know, in other words, you know what I'm saying, we're all spiritual beings experiencing a physical experience. You know what I'm saying? We're all spirits inside these bodies, which are our vehicles. And a lot of people don't understand. It's just like in the Bible when they say, God will open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing. Well, when you open up the windows of heaven, our eyes are our windows. Heaven and hell is a mindset to me. A lot of people live in hell every day in their minds. A lot of people live in heaven every day in their minds also. So when you open these eyes, that's your window of heaven. Now, whatever you want your blessings to be, God done blessed you with the day to live already. You living, that's the blessing. Everything else just to add on. So if you able to open up these windows of heaven, that right here on your face, these are the windows of heaven. If you're able to open up these windows, what kind of blessing are you going to look in the mirror and pour out to yourself and to the rest of the world?
That's what's up. That's well said, my brother. And I feel that energy every time I come across you. Get the bag, man.
Yeah.
Tell me about the clothing line, man.
Get the bag, man. You know, it's a lifestyle. We all get up every day to go get the bag. I don't care if you doggone working a job, bouncing your booty, or even if you a kingpin. You know what I'm saying? You getting up to go get the bag. Yeah, it is what it is. I mean, right now while we're in this dimension and on this planet, we're going to need money to pay for our lights, which should be free, water, which should be free, and this land that nobody is never going to own because don't nobody own earth but God.
Right.
So, you know what I'm saying? It's all a mirage, man. You know what I'm saying? They all have us on a hamster wheel running in circles to get something that ain't gonna never be yours, because everybody came into the world with nothing, and you'll leave out with nothing. You know what I'm saying? So everything that's right here in this dimension, you know what I'm saying, you're gonna need the money while you're here, but it really don't matter. I mean, it's, the money don't give you nothing but more options. That's it.
Yeah, and it really don't buy nothing, because it's like Monopoly money. People don't understand. Like, I'd rather have a friend than money. People value money over friendship. You know what I'm saying? And that's what's fucked up with the world right now today. You know, it's like family is not even second, they third. Mm-hmm. You know, it's money first, then it's me. You right. know, then it's anything after that. You know.
So my bag stands for, you know what I'm saying, generosity. Well, number one, boldness, ambition, and generosity. You know what I'm saying? So when you say get the bag, you want to get bold with yourself. You got to be bold to step out here and do whatever it is you want to do. A lot of people going to knock you. They're going to laugh at you. You know what I'm saying? I used to get jumped on when I was in Southwest Decatur because I believed in myself and other people didn't. And I see them same cats now. And they be like, you said you were going to do it. But not only did I say it, I showed you. Because actions show who you are. Words just prove who you want to be. So it's like, you know what I'm saying? You can't let nothing stop you, man. You know what I'm saying? If you got something, a desire, a goal within yourself that you want to accomplish and achieve, you got to believe in your goal and believe in you. The number one, it all starts with your thinking. Stop attempting to convince someone else and convince yourself. Make sure you convince you. That's what you got to convince the most.
So how old is this baby? When was Get the Bag born?
Get the Bag, I mean, like I said, it's a lifestyle, but I mean, it really came to me like in 2017.
Okay.
And I started on it then, you know what I'm saying? And started making it, turned it from, you know, idea or thought to what it is now, which is a clothing line and a song and my website. You can follow, you can check me out at getthebag.club. That's GETTHEBAG.CLUB. You know what I'm saying? You go to getthebag.club or at getthebag, you know what I'm saying? That's on IG at GETTHEBAG, GETTHEBAG, get on Instagram, you know what I'm saying? But this right here, I mean, it was like, okay, I was tired. My uncle, same uncle, Uncle Benny, he would tell me, man, why you throwing all your money away and all these clothes and these shoes and everything? He like, even if you did shoes, stop paying for all this money for this Versace and all this you paid all this money. I remember when Babe H, remember Red Monkey jeans was out. And everybody was buying all these jeans, man. We paying $1,600 for a pair of jeans, you know what I'm saying? And that's one pair. And he was like, man, you wasting money on this stuff. And it ain't going to be in style tomorrow. And that seed that he planted, it didn't manifest right then. It didn't hit me till later, you know, a couple of years later, like, aunt, right. I'm buying all this polo stuff. I'm buying all this Red Monkey. This ain't it. Yeah, I remember because I thought about it after it was out of style. And I was like, you know what I'm saying? It ain't in style no more.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So
I
thought about all the stuff, all the money I done gave Adidas and Nike and everybody else. So it was like, it was only right that I invest into who I believe in the most, and that's myself. So I invested in my own clothing.
Real quick. How did the Legend of the Turntable event go on December 23rd last week?
It was lit, man.
At Silk, too.
It was a great experience, man. You know what I'm saying? Everybody came out and had a great time, you know what I'm saying, for the get ready for the Christmas holidays, you know what I'm saying? It was lit, Silk. On Canada was lit, man. Right. You had myself, Kizzy Rock, DJ Jelly, DJ Phil X, DJ Jiggy, we were celebrating Jiggy's birthday, DJ Long, DJ Polo, Big Polo G. And let me see, who else is in the building? Baby D, Sam Sales.
Legends was in the building, man. We were supposed to be there tonight, man. I wasn't.
Yeah, we missed it. We were supposed to be there, man.
Yeah, man. Yeah, y'all man. Missed up, boy. Yeah. But
they took turns doing sets, right?
They took turns doing sets, you know what I'm saying? Sam and Sam performed. I performed. Pastor Troy, he was in the building. Yeah, he performed right quick. Yeah. Baby D, you know what I'm saying? So it's like, you know, It was a beautiful situation, you know what I'm saying, for the A to come together, you know, and you know, the Legends of the Turntables, man. We think the Legends of the Turntables, like I said, King Up with Jay and the J Team, the first DJ crew out of Atlanta. Then you got Oomp Camp, DJ Jelly, and DJ Monte, and MC Assault, and Big Oomp, right? And then you got, like, all the other DJ crews after that, Super Friends, Legion of Doom, Hitman DJs, Coalition DJs, you know what I'm saying? You got so many DJs, so you know what I'm saying? And that's just to name a few. But a lot of DJs in Atlanta, legends of the turntables, because they've been in the clubs for years, you know what I'm saying? And been breaking records for years, you know what I'm saying? You got DJ Hershey, you know what I'm saying? You got so many other DJs in the city, DJ Chap, DJ Skeeter, you know what I'm saying? So with that being said, we was able to help launch other artists on the platform for them to be seen and their music to be heard at the same time. So it was really killing two birds with one stone.
Yeah, and that was all attached to the same,
right.
same movie.
Same thing, yeah.
That's fire, man.
Yeah. But I mean, you know what I'm saying? I like, you know, I'm a Gemini, so I'm always thinking, like, you know what I'm saying? How can I do this and do that and bring it all together? So it's like, if I'm able to take up toys for kids and help bring in toys and make donations for that, and at the same time put somebody in front of some people to have their talents be discovered, then let's do it. Why not?
Hey, speaking of artists, do you have any artists that you working with yourself?
Yeah, I got a hard-headed nephew in here. That dog don't want to finish his music for nothing. He over there in the back over there. But he got some real nice heat, man. You know what I'm saying? But he just at the age where he just, I don't know, man. I'm going to cut his dreads. That's what I think. I'm going to cut his dreads, man. I get him thinking, playing
what
straight,
name,
man.
What name your artist, your nephew going by?
Nephew, you have to interview him, man. I'm going to let that you interview
okay.
him. Yeah,
okay.
That's why he's in here today, so you can see how interview go and he answered the questions.
That's
himself.
What's up.
Yeah.
We're gonna tap in with him.
I'm gonna let him introduce himself. He think he got a runway. My other partner DJ Spoon told him he got a runway into the music industry. So he be like, oh, I'm straight. I got a runway. But like I'm telling them, the plane just don't jump into the air. The plane got still run down the runway
exactly in
order to take off.
It got
to
gain that momentum.
Right, you got to gain the momentum. Even though you got a runway, you still got to run down this runway and gain that momentum. Today
ain't
going
to hand it
off.
To you.
Right,
you
ain't
going
to hand it to you. Yeah.
And any other artists you working with?
Yeah, I got my man X that did the Let It Burn vocals for the Social Death Baseball Star song that I had on there, Let It Burn.
Okay.
We got a new project that we're dropping called Come and Smoke With Me. He's on the, he's not my artist, but he's just my brother, you know what I'm saying? So we work together like that. But okay. As far as like artists, I have artists that I work with. They're not per se just signed to me. But the thing is like me personally, I have to find artists that can manage themselves because I already got a lot going on in my life anyway. And a lot of artists don't know how to manage themselves, meaning yeah. I've had artists that I've signed and I've had hit records for that never came out because those artists got incarcerated. It's not my fault that they got incarcerated, but they couldn't manage themselves to keep themselves from getting in trouble. So it's just like any other major label out here that has an artist that they sign and then the artist gets locked up. If the music hadn't came out before the artist got locked up, then it's just sitting there.
Yeah.
But if the music even out while the artist is locked up, then you got a hot record, but the artist can't go do no shows. He missing money from doing appearances. Yeah, the music might be getting played on the radio, but it's still going to play for so long while this artist is locked up.
That's the biggest promo killer right there.
Right, you know what I'm saying?
Up.
So it's like, you know, a lot of artists don't know how to manage themselves. So you got to learn how to manage yourself and then help me help you until I meet the artists that are able to do that. And then the other ones, they think they know it all already. You know what I'm saying? They think because they on Spotify or Tidal or Apple Music, they in the music business. And they don't understand that it's not the music business. That's just a platform. That's a streaming platform. And it is basically, you know what I'm saying, taking advantage of you. I was going to say something there, but they're taking advantage of you. They're not introducing you to the music business.
And are you still doing everything out of your studio, VIP?
Yeah, we do everything out of VIP.
With your artist?
Yeah.
Okay. Yep. Shout out to VIP Studios, man. Y'all still doing y'all thing up and running.
Yeah, man. God got us covered like a blanket of sheet and a pillowcase of feet with socks, you know. So he keeps lights, gas, phone, and water on for us.
And spoken like a true player.
You did.
You know what I'm saying?
Pimping.
That's what's up, man. We appreciate you pulling up, playing.
I appreciate
Poncho,
y'all,
man.
For having me,
always
man.
Always a cool
Thank
brother.
You.
It's always a pleasure. Always positive energy, man. Keep doing everything you're doing, man. You're a true OG out here.
Thank you, man. Thank you. It ain't going
to
stop till the casket drop. And they're going to keep going after that. You dig? So, man, I want to send y'all nothing but abundance, prosperity, peace, love, joy, excellence, and greatness. And y'all continue on as well, man. And anytime you know you want me to come through again, just hit me up, man. The number ain't going to never change. You dig?
Hey, man, that's love, man. We appreciate it, man. You watching that Frat House 11, man. Always spell the frat with them double A's, man. You
yeah.
heard? We out. What up, though? We in the frat house, man. We back, man. Frat House 11, y'all already know, man. Factual, random, artists, adult topics. Speaking of artists, man, we got another artist in the building, man. Artist and producer, man. We got DT in the building, man. The Decatur's on, baby. What's up, my brother?
What's up?
Hey, man. You a young talent out here, man. You know what I'm saying? You told me you from Decatur. You Decatur's own, man. You at home right now, man.
Yes, sir.
I hope you feel welcome in the frat house, man. We welcome all artists, man. We love independent artists such as yourself. You produce and you rap, correct?
Yes, sir.
Tell the people a little bit. We'll start with the rap first. Tell the people a little bit about what your particular style is or how you would describe it yourself.
Well, see, me personally, I like rapping about the truth. I like telling the truth to the folks. Like, I'm not just gonna give people what they wanna hear. I'm not gonna tell everybody a lie. Like, me personally, I'm old school. I grew up around old school people. When I was growing up, I was listening to David Ruffin, stuff like that. Like old school artists. Nowadays, people just killing people for no reason. And
You listen to some of the old classics?
Yes, sir.
I ain't never heard a brother your age. So how old are you?
I'm 14.
And you talking about David Ruffin?
Yes,
name me a couple more old
school
artists.
Motown in the field.
I listen to N.W.A., Tupac, Ice Cube. I mean,
What about on the singing side? One of the other old groups.
Who? David Ruffin. I mean.
You ever heard of the OJs?
Nah. I do listen to Playa Poncho. That's my uncle, for sure. Shout out to him. He the one that put me on the artist, and I appreciate him for it.
That's what's up, man. It's refreshing to hear a young artist that say they done went back and studied some of the old school stuff, because, you know, some young artists don't appreciate that, but that's where it started at, you know, that's where it came from. And you can hear a lot of good music, you know, when you dig back into the old school. Somebody like Temptations, that's what group David Ruffin from. That's big to hear you say you listen to stuff like that, some of the old school rap. Are you influenced by some of them old school lyrics?
Yes, sir. A lot of things. Like, listen to N.W.A. They actually inspired me a lot about rapping. Like a lot of songs that I listen to. Like, I listen to them and I think, and I just try to see what I can learn from those songs. Like, back in the day, they had a lot of stuff going on. That's when they was rapping about the truth and not just killing people all the time.
So you deal with real content, like in your lyrics, like some of the reality rap, the political stuff, like just real subjects in general? You touch on some of that stuff?
Yes, sir. I always make sure to do that in my rap.
That's what's up. Now, on the production side, how do you feel about your sound? Like, what would you compare your sound to? Or are you creating a whole new thing out here?
To be honest, I would like to create a whole new thing. And my sound is my sound, just like everybody else's sound is their sound. So it's like, I have my own sound, y'all have your own sound, just as I have my own voice and everybody else has their own voice.
Like, when you produce a beat, let me give you an example of what I'm trying to ask you. When you produce a beat automatically, like, do you produce for, like, your own liking? Like, if you produce the beat right now, is it something you feel like you could jump right on? Or are you, like, more versatile and you just do whatever you're feeling at that time?
More versatile, because I like to open up to new things and learn different things. Because at the end of the day, I'm trying to be a better person than I was last time.
Oh, okay. So do you feel like, not only for yourself, you feel like you could produce for somebody else, an artist totally different from yourself?
Yes, sir. Most likely, because if you come to me trying to produce a song and you want to hear a certain type of beat, it's like you like what you like just as I like what I like. So I'm gonna try to, no, not try, I'm going to help you the best way I can in order to help you succeed and strive to be better artists in the upcoming industry.
That's what's up. You sound like you're serious about your craft. What made you want to start this in the first place? Like, what was the moment that you said to yourself, yeah, I can rap, I can write something, or I can make a beat?
That day, I went to the studio with my Uncle P. We was in there chilling, and I just decided, okay, I like the way this sound. So I started rapping to it in my head, and I went home listening to music, just vibing in my room.
Okay.
No chilling. And I thought to myself, if I can rap on this, if I can do this and turn it into something else, but something positive and not negative, then I can probably influence the world to change the way things are going in the world right now.
So you definitely got something to say then.
Yes, sir.
That's what's up. Which one do you feel like you like better, rapping or producing?
Rapping most definitely, because I get to experience new things, and I get to tell the world what I have to say and show them how I feel, regardless of what anybody cares about, because my opinion is my opinion.
That's what's up, man. Hey, tell the folks where they can find you at, DT. You know what I'm saying? Give them your plugs, all of that stuff. You know what I'm saying?
So my IG is You Know She Love X. I'll soon to be make my business IG. That's just my personal. Y'all can hit me up on there if y'all wanna talk to me about some stuff. Also, my new IG is gonna be DT. DT. If you wanna know, I'll let y'all know. I'll be posting upcoming music on there, little clips. But y'all hear from me most definitely.
That's what's up, man. Appreciate you, DT, man. Thank you for pulling up in the frat house. We love young talents such as yourself, man. Y'all already know y'all watching that YouTube, man. At Frat House 11, Factual Random Artists, Adult Topics. Always spell the frat with them double A's, you heard? Salute. We out of here.